things in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. I hope those on Zoom and AACS TV is doing well today in the name of our Lord and Savior. Today I want to take the word of God from the book of St. Matthew Gospel, chapter 24, reading from verse 8 to 12. And I've read this message several times, but there's more reason why I'm going to preach on this message this morning. And this is Jesus Christ speaking. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because of the lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Eternal, most precious, heavenly Father, speak your word this morning to all recipients, Lord. Let their hearts pay attention to this time and season, that they will not be deceived, but they will remain focused upon your word and acknowledge you as their personal Savior. This I declare and decree in none other name but our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. Amen. You know, I love the word of God. And the more we dive into this 21st century, we see continuously the manifestations of all God's prophecies being fulfilled. It was just a couple of days this week. My wife and I, we were driving and we heard this message over the radio station that the computer now randomly selected an app that you can speak to Jesus Christ directly. You can speak to Peter, James, and John, and Mother Mary. They also develop an app that you can speak to Satan. Wow, look at this craziness. I mean, for thousands of years, disciples and prophets and apostles could have speak to God Almighty.
Yeah, man.
Jesus Christ walked this earth. And they're going to speak to Jesus Christ also, right?
Right.
Well, it's nothing new. People have been speaking to Satan for years. Mm-hmm. There wasn't no computerized act for that. But this is just another trick of the enemy.
That's right.
A concoction of the enemy.
That's right.
You see, the word of God can't lie. Mm-hmm. This generation in this time and season will be wiser and wiser in their own ways. And the devil know that they're stupid. And if he can get them to be speaking to false Jesus on the computer that man himself made and developed, but then in the need to pray and worship God in spirit and truth.
Exactly.
But it doesn't stand there. There was another situation, and Lord, give me grace. Give me wisdom and understanding. A black African preacher told his congregation, I'm going to pay God some money to come from heaven and preach to my congregation. And that Sunday, some white man showed up with blonde hair and a half dingy robe. He looked handsome, but when you look into his eyes, you can see the abyss of hell in his soul. And the young people, adorning in nice clothes, taking photographs, taking shots with Jesus. Hey, Jesus, come to earth. Let me get some shots with Jesus. When we see these things, deception, how worse can it get? And I don't believe it stopped there yet.
It's the beginning.
It's the beginning.
That's right.
But Christ is calling for his children, his blood washed, anointed, appointed, polished, groomed, adorned in his righteousness.
Amen.
To remain focused in this time and season.
That's right.
I'm calling to every fake church that pours in mockery, that pretending that they know Jesus Christ, that they know God Almighty, wake up and repent.
Amen.
For hell is awaiting you.
That's right.
The time for repentance is more needed now than ever. Because
mm-hmm.
God draws nigh.
Mm-hmm.
His return draws near.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And the devil is modeling and he's sculpturing methodologies to brainwash and sabotage this generation. This generation that we living among are far off the path of following Jesus Christ. The so-called church, the fake church, is just brainwashing these young people. Church becomes an entertainment center. It's an entertainment package. Everything catering to the physical body, the physical needs, but are they catering to the spirit of Almighty God? Are they teaching you the direction to worship Christ in spirit and in truth? When we come to a place like this in society, multitudes will be deceived. For the word of God said that many shall come in my name, preach in my name, cast out demons in my name, do deliverances in my name, and still come to Christ and say, I know you're not, you workers of iniquity.
Mm-hmm.
Witchcraft become the foundation of many so-called churches today. They craft mind manipulation methodologies to keep people in bondage. No one is walking free. And the word of God said, who the Spirit set free is free indeed. No one is worshiping Christ in spirit and in truth. They are worshiping the icons of society. They are worshiping the coin they elected. They are worshiping the old stings. They are worshiping the TV Jakes. They are worshiping a lot of false gods. They preach sweet. They dress elegant. They look right. They have mansions. They have schools. They have it all. But do they have Jesus Christ at the four corners of their life? Do they have Jesus Christ at the center of their lives? These so-called bishops and preachers attending parties where women whining and twerking their bodies up on them, and then get behind a pulpit and call themselves men and women of God. It's blasphemy. Oh, it's okay. We can't be so righteous that we can't come down and party a little bit. It's okay that we walk into church with boom showing. This is God's body. It's fine to show it off. There is a criteria.
Mm-hmm.
God has standards.
Yes.
Absolutely. And his standards had to be adhered to. There was a time in life that women was modestly dressed.
All of the time.
Men was modestly dressed. You got guys going to church, man, and kerchief out their pocket and the belt's dropping low, and if you don't be careful, you see the underwears and earrings in the ears and hair plait and you name it. You can't tell the social nightclub from the churches today. And all those where thousands of people are following every day is because the church is cultivating an atmosphere of the world. The pastors and the bishops and the leaders and the apostles and the prophets can't care less about the word of God. All they care less is about making money in the church and driving the expensive cars and riding on high mighty airplanes. This is what they're concerned about. Dressing in $1,200 suits. No one could care about Jesus Christ. Deception is ravishing our society. And the true men and women of God, you can't stand normal anymore. There has to be a standard of abnormality You've got to speak the word of God wholeheartedly. You've got to speak the word of God even in your workplace. You've got to speak the word of God in your colleges. You've got to speak the word of God on the playing fields. You've got to speak the word of God in the party houses. You've got to speak the word of God even in the casinos. You've got to speak the word of God in places that are desolate, because no one is going to get set free unless they come into an atmosphere where the word of God is being spoken. We are living in a time where the devout men and women of God got to go into very, very dark places under the anointing of the Holy Spirit to bring some people out of bondage. This word is suffering. This word is waiting for a fresh word. This word is waiting for a fresh anointing from God. But unless the men and women of God get out of their comfort zone and step into the atmosphere where there is darkness and break the chains of hell, our brothers and sisters will be in turmoil and conflict for their eternal life. We have an obligation as members in the body of God. It's okay to come to church. It's okay to come here on Sundays and worship. But the anointing that God has bestowed upon you goes beyond the four walls of the corner of the church. You have a daily obligation to God to set someone's life free by speaking the unadulterated word of God into somebody's life. There are many prostitutes out there. They don't like the life they're living in. But no one's gonna that call themselves righteous wanna walk and talk to a prostitute. People think I'm one of those. No one wants to talk to a gun buyer. Oh, he's a gangster and in church. No one don't want to talk to someone who commit murder. Come on, Christ did come to save the righteous, but call sinners to repentance. Amen. And until we take up the full mantle of the Holy Spirit and go to dark places and release the word of God, light will not shine in those dark places. Amen. We have an obligation of God to set the captive free for out of captivity of sin. And every day as we live, every day as we thrive, we see more and more false worshipers. They call God names sweet. I am Dr. So-and-so. I have a doctor in theology. Many apostles and prophets back in those days had a university education. They was educated by the Holy Spirit himself. They was educated by Jesus Christ himself. Many of those people who rose up to be men, devout men and women of God, were at the feet of Jesus Christ himself. Let the word of God be your counsel. Let the word of God be your life. For it's food to your belly and marrow to your bones. In all our lives, we just do one thing over and over every day. We go to church. We get a nice sermon. We shake it off as soon as we get through the door. We go to work. We shower, come back home. Do the same thing over and over until Sunday come again. We as members in the body of Christ has to spiritually strategize with the Holy Spirit. We got a task on our hands. We got a duty and responsibility as members in the body of Christ in our hands. And that is to deliver the word of God effectively and absolutely as the Spirit gives utterance to your brothers and sisters, that they can be released from the turmoil of sin, that they can be released of the conflicts of life, that they can come to worship God in spirit and the truth. That they can understand that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, who was, who is, and who is to come. The days for playing church has to stop. Hear me, every recipient of this word, every member in the body of Christ, every single heart, open your eyes to the word of God. Open your hearts to the word of God. Incline your ears to the Holy Spirit that he can come into your life revolutionary. revolutionize your life that you can want a victorious life. Your life as a Christian has to reflect the glory of God. Your life as a Christian has to be a guiding, navigating compass to your brothers and sisters around you. It has to be a navigating compass in your community. It has to be a navigating compass in your schools. It has to be a navigating compass in your workplace. It has to be a navigating compass throughout your life. The word of God is food to your belly and marrow to your bones. The word of God spells eternal life. It's time to adorn yourself in righteousness. Know that we serve a King of kings and a Lord of lords. The time for playing churches has to stop. You don't have to be called reverend. You don't have to be called pastor. You don't have to be called apostle. You don't have to be called bishop. You don't have to be called deacon. You don't have to be called anything. All you have to be called is a son and a daughter of the living God. And my God said, I will put myself into you, that every spoken word from out of your lips is a spoken word of the Holy Spirit himself. And many shall come to know me as their personal Savior. We have that obligation. And it means we ourselves have to prepare further our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable before God. The nice things of life, the fancy lifestyle, has to sit there second position in your life. It has to sit there second boundaries in your life. God has to be foremost in your life. Because all these beautiful things that this world has to offer is going to pass away. We came into this world empty-handed and naked, clinching to nothing. And we are going out of this world with nothing. The things that a dead man, a dead rich man, and a dead poor man has in common, they're going to get buried 6 feet deep and rotten to bones, and no one will ever remember you again. I mean, they could establish a monument. But there are a whole lot of monuments all across the United States of America. Anyone was thinking about George Washington, by the way? Absolutely not. He was the first president of the United States. Nobody don't think about him. He served his time in God. But did he serve Jesus Christ? That I don't know. But you and I have that destiny with death. But the question is, when you lie down one night, and God extract his spirit, and your spirit come up your body, and look down on your body,
God help us,
and recognize you can't move anymore. And some realities start to get in your spirit. The same spirit that you should be worshiping God in spirit and in truth. And the realities start to get into your spirit. And your track records start to get into your spirit.
Yes.
Oh God, what have I done all my life? I did nothing right. I didn't even serve you. Oh God, what's going to happen here now? And you recognize that the spirit gone back to God. Your body gone to the grave. But where does it leave the soul? You see, the soul is a main thing because there are a lot of restless souls walking this earth. And it's full body shape. It looks like me. It talks like me. Your soul still lives here. Your spirit going back to God. The spirit that he gave you, that you should worship him in spirit and truth, it going back to God. And this kind of body gone to the grave or the crematorium. But where does it leave the soul? Where is your soul? Because that is what's going to get called into question. There are millions and millions of roaming souls all over this earth. They are in misery. There's no peace because God said there's no peace for the wicked. But in the point where your soul is in Christ, is with Christ, you are resting in heavenly places. You are resting in peace until God's return. And that's why people don't seem to understand that there's so much haunted houses all across America. Poor souls walking in conflict and turmoil and pain, but they don't seem to know what's going on. They wish they could get back into the body, but unfortunately, the body that when they first experienced that, they was all of, they can't reach out or try to get back into it because that body eventually disappears. Rottenness, decayed, and no one seems to able to get back in their bodies. That's it. And the demons of hell start to surround you. Some dark forces and say, hey, you ain't going anywhere. You was with us all your life. Come, we're going down to the abyss of hell. We're going to purgatory. And you're in conflict, you're in turmoil. You're there in turmoil to judgment there. But what happens? Now, this separate the righteous from the unrighteous. When you die in Christ, there's a comfort zone. There is a resting place that you will rest in peace. When Christ said that we are heirs and joint heirs to the throne of God, when you become a new creation in the body of Christ, you are a royal priest of the chosen generation. God is not going to allow your soul to be tormented or augmented by any demonic forces of hell. It was never permitted in the earth when you were alive, and neither will it be permitted when you are dead. So for those who think that when you die, that's it, I have nothing to worry about, that's not real. It's far from the truth. But we have a time in our lives when everyone, it doesn't matter whether you're righteous or unrighteous, the word of God declared that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Jesus Christ. I don't care how much atheist you are, how much devil you believe in. Oh, the devil, he believe in Jesus Christ too. He know who's superior over him. He's the one who started the battles in heaven in the first place and who took him out, who cast him out. The King of Kings, well, I am God. I am the creator. I am one who made you. You can't get in my face. Out you go. And one third of his angels went with him. So God is saying, this is a time and season to be aware of the false antics and methodologies that the devil will bring to you. Be aware of the false prophets, the false apostles, the false teachers, the false pastors, the false doctors. Just be aware of this time and season that they have gone up into the world to deceive as many as they possibly can. For the word of God said that they will be deceived in multitudes, that even the very elect themselves would have been deceived if they were not at God's right hand.
Amen.
We have to be vigilant. We have to be cautious to what's going on in our environment. We are the salt of the earth. And if we lost our savor, where else can we be resalted? We are a light that establish upon a city. We give light to darkness. But if that light go out, who's going to give the light? We have an obligation as members in the body of Christ, true worshipers in the body of Christ, to wholeheartedly worship him and serve him in spirit and in truth, to wholeheartedly deliver the word of God in its absoluteness to all humanity, all four corners of this earth. That's our obligation as members in the body of Christ. That's our obligation as sons and daughters of God. That's our obligation as heirs and joint heirs to the throne of God. That's our obligation as a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, and a peculiar kind of a people. That's our obligation. We are obligated, if we are fully serving God in spirit and in truth, to do his will in earth as it is in heaven. The time for playing around has to be put to an end. No longer let a counterfeit life. Sin has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Adultery has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Fornication has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Stealing has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Murder has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Prostitution has to be buried. It has to be crucified. Worshiping false God has to be buried. It has to be crucified. God said all this dark atmosphere has to be buried are crucified. If we are to be resurrected with Jesus Christ, our King, we must bury the sinful nature for the spiritual nature to rise in this time and season. We have to crucify it. We can't play church anymore because the darkness of hell will be prevailing before every single pulpit. But the devil is a liar, for Christ said, I will expose them in this time of season. I will tear the church down and I'll build it back up in the name of Jesus. The word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, and cut by it bindeth you up. We can't pretend anymore. We can't fool people anymore, because you can't fool God. You're either one for out or one for in. Mm-hmm. You can't serve two masters at the same time. You either cling to one and love the other. We can't serve two masters at the same time. We can't serve sin and righteousness at the same time. Eternal and most gracious Heavenly Father, I pray to every single recipient of your word right now this morning, especially those on AACSD, Lord, that you will release a sense of understanding, wisdom, the ability to turn away from their sinful nature, their sinful ways, Lord, and acknowledge you through by repentance and acknowledging you as their personal Savior. Lord, not by repeating the sinner's prayer, but by their heart inwardly repenting that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that they repent of their sinful nature, that they will love to be born again, not of the flesh, but of the Holy Spirit, Lord. Lord, this I declare and decree in none other name but our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.